Hello people, in this video let us look at rheumatic fever, which will also be associated with rheumatic heart disease. So basically what is this? This is an autoimmune focal inflammatory disorder. So basically what happens here, a person just gets a sore throat. So when he gets a sore throat, he's attacked by streptococcus. The body tries to attack this streptococcus, but whatever antibodies our body prepares will also go and attack our heart, right? So causing rheumatic heart disease. So basic concept you have understood, guys, that person just gets a throat infection, right? That is a streptococcal infection. So let us say there's a throat infection or a streptococcal infection for which our body produces antibodies, right? And the antibodies which are produced in a body not only attack the streptococcus, because the proteins are similar to what are there on our heart, these antibodies will also attack the heart, right? Especially the mitral valve, etc. This is the heart I'm trying to draw. So these antibodies will also attack the heart and our synovial joints, etc. So are you understanding, guys? So basically there is an antigen which has entered, right? And you are preparing antibodies. So basically this is type 2 hypersensitivity. It is a post-streptococcal non-suppurative. There's no pus here, non-suppurative. When you open the heart and see, there will actually be no pus and all that. Only this reaction between the antibody and the proteins on the heart, right? Only that you will see. Right, so it is non-suppurative. It's a systemic disease. So you're calling it as rheumatic fever. It affects the heart. That time it will become rheumatic heart disease. It will also affect the joints, the central nervous system, the skin and subcutaneous tissue. So it's systemic. It's not leaving anything. So if it affects the heart, rheumatic heart disease. If it affects the joints, you'll have arthritis and central nervous system. These people can have chorea. They will dance, kind of a thing. And skin, you will see erythema marginatum, isn't it? And subcutaneous tissues, you're seeing some nodules, kind of a thing. So guys, we will look at all these in detail. Just hold on. So basically, I think in pathology, you have already looked at all this, isn't it? Here, we're looking at it in medicine perspective. Let us just see some extra details. So the layers of the heart which are involved, guys, you know what and all are there, right? In the heart, you have the endocarditis, then you have the myocarditis, and you have the pericarditis. So all the three layers can be involved, and that will be called as pancarditis. Okay. So this you will see in children 5 to 15 years of age. Remember, rheumatic heart disease. So just generally, if we have to tell you, you will treat it with steroids for this pericarditis, etc. You will give aspirin for arthritis. You will give valproate for chorea. You can also give IVIG, that is IV immunoglobulins, right? You can give benzathine, penicillin, IM every 3 weeks for around 5 to 10 years or up till the person is 21 or 40, depending on the conditions and severity. So to prevent recurrence, okay? And if the person is allergic to penicillin, you can give azithromycin. So these are some very high level information about this problem, that is rheumatic fever. It is very common in India. So basically what happens here, the streptococcus, molecular mimicry and cross reactivity. Right, here who is attacking you? The group A streptococci will attack you. The proteins on this resemble the proteins in our body, and then our body will think it is streptococcus and it will start attacking the heart and your joints, etc. Okay, so there is molecular mimicry and cross reactivity. Okay, so let us look at this. This table is important. Look at this. So the antigen cross reactivity, look at this, guys. Focus here, please. Streptococcal antigen. Which antigen is the streptococcus bringing? It is bringing M protein, and our heart myocardium has very similar antigen. Okay, and it has C carbohydrate, cell wall C carbohydrate. Our valves have the same antigen, peptidoglycan. Our skin has those peptidoglycan type of things, so we will start attacking our own skin. Cytoplasmic membrane, so again glomerular vascular intima, so it is affecting the kidney. Glomerular vascular intima. Okay, then hyaluronic acid, synovial fluid. So all your joints are also affected. So you can understand the cross reactivity between the streptococcal antigens and the human proteins. Let us say, why call them as antigens? Anyways, okay. So you got this much, guys. How's it going so far? Take a break. Understand. What are we looking at? Streptococcus and human. How the protein which is there in streptococcus is so similar to what is there in our body. So when the streptococcus comes and attacks us, we will make antibodies. But the antibodies will start attacking our own tissues also. Isn't it? So where are we now? Here. So basically, what are they telling here? So causes, they're saying environment factors are there, host factors are there, immunological evidence, etc. So basically, these people will have an azo titer greater than 200 because they have a streptococcal infection, isn't it? So anti-DNase B you can detect in these people. You can detect what, cell wall polysaccharide of group A streptococcus, right? All this you will be able to identify. Okay. So now we are moving on to RHD, that is rheumatic heart disease. Look at this. It is a sequel of rheumatic fever. It is a complication of rheumatic fever, you can say. There will be cardiac lesions and extracardiac lesions. Cardiac lesions will be something like here. You can see they have shown you that what and all they have shown. Let us see this yellow dots. Can you see, guys? So they have shown some deposit kind of a thing. It is deposited on the tricuspid valve, on the pulmonary valve. It is also deposit on the aortic valve, mitral valve, etc. What is not affected that much is your pulmonary valve, guys. Mainly what is affected is your mitral and the aortic valve. So what will happen when the mitral valve, as you can see here, guys, focus here and please pay attention. Look at the mitral valve. Okay, so look at the mitral valve here. So here you can see the mitral valve, some deposits are there, right? So some vegetations they are saying. Because of this, what happens? There can be regurgitation of the blood from the left ventricle to the left atria. So let's draw some blood going back here. So left ventricle to left atria, the blood can go back. So there can be mitral regurgitation, which will cause this McCallum's patch. It's called as mural endocarditis, which will be where in your right, I'm sorry, left, right? Yeah. Left atrium, what will you find? McCallum's patch, mural endocarditis. Why? Because of the blood going back from your left ventricle to left atria. Very good, guys. Very good. So I think you are getting an idea what we are trying to look at, right? Guys, we are looking at what? Rheumatic heart disease. Are you awake? Very good. So let's proceed, guys, to the next slide here. So cardiac lesions is caused by these vegetations, Ashcroft nodules, they're calling it as, or Ashcroft bodies. Right, and they're giving you some details here. Histology, basically there's something called as Anischov cells or caterpillar cells which are normal in the heart. Okay, so look at this. You can see that this is the cross section, right? Longitudinally looks like this, like a caterpillar. You can see inside like a caterpillar, and in the cross section it's looking like a dot. But yeah, these are the Anischov cells and these are normal. So let's use a green here. So basically these are normally present. You can see Anischov cells here, so many are marked, but these have come together and what they are called, they have, you can see inside this huge, inside this thing there are a lot of Anischov cells. Can you see this? So this is an Ashcroft cell. So this is abnormal. Okay, so let's mark this with red. This one is abnormal. Ashcroft nodules, Ashcroft bodies are abnormal, guys. So did you understand? Very easy. The caterpillar ones are actually normal. So Anischov cells, caterpillar cells are normal. They join to give the pathologic giant cell called Ashcroft bodies. This is what you should understand. These are what are the vegetations which are depositing in your heart. Okay, guys. So look at this. They are telling early how it will be and late how will it be. Early how these Ashcroft nodules will be, then intermediate how they will be. See this. Then late how they will be, there will be fibrosis, healing or fibrosis stage, guys. Look at this if you want. Now let's move on to pancarditis. So where there we saw that endocarditis, you saw that there will be McCallum's patch and mitral valve vegetations, right? So you have valvulitis, mural endocarditis. So basically the innermost layer of your heart, endocarditis, isn't it? Then myocarditis will be the muscle part of it and pericarditis around the heart. So we have to look at everything they are seeing. So valvulitis, guys, they are telling how the valve will look. So here you can see that, you can see the mitral valve, right? This is the left atrium and left ventricle. Middle, they have shown the mitral valve here. So people, basically this, can you see here? The end of this leaflet is affected. So that is what you have to focus on, okay? The leaflet, whatever touches, right? So one more leaflet here, that is affected. So here you can see what are they showing here? There's congestion. Mononuclear cells, edema. What exactly is this? Fibrin platelet thrombus. Okay. So valvulitis, how will the valve be? Thick, loss of translucency, vegetations or verruque will be there. Gray, brown. They do not get detached to form emboli, which is good for us, is it? Mitral valve is the most affected. Then aortic valve is affected. Pulmonary is least affected, we told you guys. Then left heart is affected more because of the, you know, left heart has more things to do in life. So it's affected more, looks like. And what are you seeing here? In chronic stage, you can see how the mitral valve, there is permanent deformity. There is a fish mouth kind of a valve, right? Fish. So let's draw a fish. You remember how we used to draw fish like this? We used to draw fish with its mouth open like this sometimes, remember? So imagine from the front you're looking how it will be. The fish mouth will be like this, right? So this is fish mouth deformity. And then what is this? This is some triangle. Let us see what you're seeing here. This is the aortic valve, which is triangle. The up one here is mitral valve. Okay. These are the vegetations in RHD. So the mitral valve will become fish mouth or buttonhole stenosis. This is buttonhole. When you put a button, there's a hole to put the button, something like that. Okay. Then there is thickening, shortening, and fusion of the caudate endine. So caudate endine, which is where is caudate endine, you will ask. So let us say this is the heart, right? And here you have the mitral valve. So this mitral valve is totally affected. The caudate endine will be something like this, right? Attaching it to the papillary muscle, right? So you have understood everything. Now let's go to the next slide. Let's see what is there here. Microscopic view, they are saying you will see this ash of nodules, ash of bodies, right? Then vegetations. Then in the healed or chronic stage, you will see that there will be thickening of these valves. There will be no ash of bodies, no bacteria. Basically, it is no bacteria all the time. There is no suppuration here, right? It is just a reaction cross, cross, what did this say? Cross? Yeah, cross reactivity, molecular mimicry. Okay. Mimicry means what? The protein on Streptococcus is very similar to the protein on our heart. You can say the Streptococcus is trying to mimic our own protein. Something like that you can say, right? Great, guys. Now let's look at the next slide here. Mural endocarditis. So basically, they're talking about mural. Mural is what? What's the meaning of mural? Mural endocarditis. This one. Baculum's patch. Okay, we told you. So basically, because of the blood flowing back, there because of mitral regurgitation, the blood will hit the left atrium wall and it will cause Baculum patch, mural endocarditis. So posterior wall of the left atrium is affected, guys. A map-like area, if you can see it, what is Baculum patch? It's a map-like area in the posterior wall of the left atrium, which is near the posterior leaflet of the mitral valve. Okay, mitral valve is bicuspid; it has only anterior and posterior leaflet, isn't it? So microscopically, again, same things you'll mention: Anichkov cells, Ashkov bodies, macrophage, lymphocytes, edema, fibrinoid changes, etc. Standard things they've written in microscopy. So what is happening to the mitral valve? We told you the commissural end is involved. That is, the touching parts are involved. There can be mitral regurgitation. There can be a flow murmur because that's you know it flows from the left atrium to left ventricle. The blood flows in such a way that there is a lot of murmur, flow murmur. This is not because of any stenosis or anything. Here there is flow murmur. Right, and this is also called as Carrie-Coombs murmur. This will be a diastolic murmur, obviously, because when will the left ventricle get the blood? It will get the blood when it is relaxing. That is, in diastole only, the blood from the left atrium will come to the left ventricle. So this is going to what kind of murmur you will see? Diastolic murmur. This will be a mid or a late diastolic murmur. Basically, you will see a mid or a late diastolic murmur where in rheumatic heart disease, it is a flow murmur because of the blood flowing here. Aortic murmur is that you can say it is because of rheumatic heart disease. It will be a flow murmur, rheumatic heart disease, mid diastolic murmur. When will it come? In the diastole. So this is the diastole, that is after S2 but before S1. So this is the diastole. So here you are seeing the mid diastolic murmur. We are talking about rheumatic heart disease. Guys, now they are talking about myocarditis. How is the myocarditis? See, you what have I seen now? Talked now was about the endocarditis, the inside of the heart. Now we are talking about the muscle of the heart, myocarditis, guys. Are you okay? What are we looking at in rheumatic heart disease? We looked at endocarditis over in that valvulitis, everything we saw. Now we are going to myocarditis, the muscle of the heart. Muscle of the heart, what is happening? Basically, here also ash of bodies. Then where in the intraventricular septum, they are saying everywhere, left atrium, left ventricle, everything. Right, basically you have to talk about the muscle, so they're talking about the septum here because of these ash of nodules which are there between the SA node and the AV node. Guys, focus here. We have written a point here, you can see, because between the SA node and the AV node there are ash of nodules. There'll be slow conduction because of which the PR interval will be more. Okay, so if this is the heart, I'm not able to draw it well. Okay, here. So basically, here you have the SA node, let's say, and here you have the AV node. So basically, when the conduction between the SA node and AV node is affected because of a lot of ash of nodules, then the conduction will be slow, and hence you can have a increased PR interval. Okay, so a prolonged PR interval, where will you see? In the ECG, in rheumatic, myocarditis, very good people. How will you treat all this problem? You will give diuretics, morphine, you will give nitrates, etc. Okay. Then, coming to pericarditis. So now we have come outside of the heart, from inside, now we have reached the outside. So basically, here you can see there are two types of pericardium in this photo. They have shown visceral and parietal pericardium. So this is the parietal, sorry, this is the pericardial cavity between these two pericardiums, right? And around that pericardial cavity, they have shown fibrous pericardium. So you should know there is serous pericardium, fibrous, wow, so many. Okay, so now basically what will happen here? There is inflammatory involvement of the pericardium. So there's a loss of shiny surface, this deposition of fibrin. Fibrin is exudate. So what will happen? There will be a bread butter appearance. Remember, loss of shiny fur surface. But when, why will it appear like butter then? Strange. Okay, then there will be chronic adhesive pericarditis. So when will they see this gross, guys? What do you think? When can you see the heart? If you have opened it up, or is it after death? But remember, if there's bread butter appearance of the pericardium, you can say it is rheumatic pericarditis. Microscopically, you will see same thing, ash of bodies. Please do not forget to mention them. Now let us go to extracardiac lesions, guys. So we are done with rheumatic heart disease, right? Now let's go to extracardiac lesions. Guys, extracardiac lesions are something like, we told you it can affect the joints, so there can be arthritis. Here it says it will be a migratory arthritis, polyarthritis, that is multiple joints are involved one after the other. But remember that you should not wait for it to migrate, and you should not wait for a monoarthritis to become a polyarthritis. Okay, you should suspect rheumatic fever. Subcutaneous nodules, we told you skin can be involved. Then erythema marginatum shown here. You can see this, you can see more in the pale skin people. Then you have chorea minor here, shown here. This is also called as Sydenham's chorea or Saint Vitus dance. This is a neurological manifestation. Then you have rheumatic arthritis and pneumonitis and pleuritis. So just remember these four are important, guys. Polyarthritis, subcutaneous nodules, erythema marginatum, and chorea. Chorea, chorea, chorea is the dance. Okay, this is the dance. Okay, where are we here? So they're talking in detail about polyarthritis. This is migratory, but don't wait for the migration to happen. Suspect in the beginning. Why is this happening? There is ash of bodies, right, in the joint cavities. So you should treat this with aspirin, etc. Just arthritis, right? You can peel, treat it. Now, subcutaneous nodules. One thing, just going back here, guys. Aspirin and all, you should remember Reye's syndrome it can cause, right? So in whom can it cause, and all that you should know. You can also give naproxen. Subcutaneous nodules, we told you skin can be affected, guys. Just go and understand this. Subcutaneous nodules, again, you will see giant ash of bodies in histology. Okay, this is painless, looks like. That's why it's in green. Nice, na? What are we looking at, guys? Extracardiac lesions of rheumatic fever. Very good. So what are we looking at now? Subcutaneous nodules. Very, very good. Let's continue. Okay, these are not, they don't even notice those nodules because it's painless. Okay, erythema marginatum, you can see in light skin people. Basically, this is also very nice. Non-itching, non-pruritic. Again, this is migratory. Okay, migratory only. This is also something, everything keeps from moving from one place to the other. Central clearing will be there, and red margin. Central clearing you'll also have in tinea, right? Fungal infection. But this one is like, you see, it is not circular. And what is it? Central clearing and red margins. Okay, and it's more in the proximal parts like the trunk. Now let's go to chorea minor, Sydenham's chorea, Saint Vitus dance, guys. Involuntary jerky movements, especially in girls. You can see it's this is accompanied by some emotional instability. So I'm thinking this is nuclear. What am I saying? Neurological manifestation. What is affected here is the basal ganglia, the caudate nucleus. Okay, guys. So basically, this is showing you the chorea. When they put their tongue out, it will be snake-like, darting tongue. So basically, you can understand, guys. If the patient, if people are complaining that this patient is actually lying, you can ask them to show their tongue, and it will be snake or darting type. Basically, hopefully the patient doesn't know that this is one of the symptoms and they are not faking it. Anyway, so then how will you treat chorea? No need to treat, it will go away by itself. But otherwise, if you want to treat, then you'll have to give valproate, etc. For refractory chorea, they are talking about IVIG. That means you cannot treat it and it's not just going away, is it? Okay, IVIG is IV immunoglobulins. Then rheumatic arthritis, rheumatic pneumonitis, pleuritis, not so important looks like, and there's no ash of nodules here. Interesting. Now coming to the diagnosis, you have revised Jones criteria. Guys, you should have at least two major criteria or one major with two minor criteria, or you can have three minor criteria to detect recurrence. Okay. So two major or one minor and sorry, what am I saying? Hold on. Two major. Can you say two major?
Major.
Yeah, two major. One major.
One major.
Plus two minor.
Two minor.
Yeah. So remember these two guys. Say two major or one major and two minor. Okay. This is revised Jones criteria. What are the major and minor? Let's see. Major is something like carditis, polyarthritis, subcutaneous nodules, erythema marginatum, and chorea. Guys, pay attention here. So the heart is affected, joints are affected. Subcutaneous nodules can be there, erythema marginatum, skin is involved, or chorea. Remember, arthritis and chorea cannot coexist at the same time. They can come one after the other. Okay, so what are the major criteria? Can you say carditis?
Carditis.
Polyarthritis.
Polyarthritis.
Subcutaneous.
Subcutaneous.
Nodules.
Nodules.
Okay, erythema marginatum and chorea, guys. So I hope you will remember them five. Things are there in major criteria. Then coming to minor criteria, fever, arthralgia. So basically here they are not telling polyarthritis. Don't wait for it to be migratory and all that. Even if it's a monoarthralgia, pay attention to it. There can be elevated CSR with C-reactive protein also greater than some 3 mg per deciliter. Elevated ESR means greater than 30 mm fall. Okay. Prolonged PR interval, we told you, because where will you see this, guys? If the myocardium is involved, isn't it? Very good. Then if there is a previous history of RF, it's written here. Preceding, so major and minor you came to know, guys, so you can understand how to diagnose rheumatic fever. But then you have to confirm it with lab. You have to check for streptococcal throat infection, which was there around 45 days or whatever back. So you will check for azotiter, anti-streptokinase, anti-streptohyaluronidase, anti-DNase B, rapid group A strep carbohydrate test, because we told you that streptococcus mimics the proteins in our heart or in other parts of our body, right? So you can try to detect any one of them, right? So you can detect what and all. We told you about the carbohydrate, we told you about the M protein, we told you about so many other proteins which try to mimic the proteins in our heart. Sorry, in our body. So we already showed you this. M protein, heart, C protein, cardiac valves, peptidoglycan, skin, cytoplasmic membrane, the kidney can get affected, hyaluronic acid, synovial fluid. Okay. So you have understood. So you will try to detect these proteins or you will try to detect the antibodies. Last slide, guys. Let's finish it off. So basically, rheumatic heart, what did you see? Long-term sequel, complications, pancarditis. So guys, basically what we told you, the heart is totally affected. There can be arrhythmias, there can be mitral stenosis, there can be cardiac failure, embolism, but not from the valve they are seeing, but from mural thrombi. So, and it can affect all the organs. Sudden death can occur. I'm guessing because of this endoembolism or because of the heart cardiac failure, isn't it? So that's it, guys. We are done with this rheumatic fever, rheumatic heart disease, and all the extracardiac lesions also. So hope you have understood rheumatic heart disease, rheumatic fever, etc. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.